Pastor, would you begin with a brief overview of the Gospel of Matthew? And then we can ask a couple of specific questions on Matthew.
Okay. Yes. The Gospel of Matthew, in our Bibles, where we have both the Hebrew Scriptures and the New Testament put together, you turn from the last book in our Bibles, that is Malachi, and you turn to the first book in the New Testament, is the Gospel of Matthew. Now, the Gospel of Matthew was clearly the, at least in the beginning, many years, centuries, was the most popular, well-liked gospel. And probably one reason is it has got the teachings of Jesus all well summarized or put together in blocks of teaching. And that is one of the specialities or unique features of the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew, why not we turn there? Why not we look at the very first verse? And when you read that, Matthew will say, this is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David and the son of Abraham. And when you read in the Greek text, it says, Biblos Genesios, the genesis of Jesus Christ, son of David, son of Abraham. At once, you are again reminded of Genesis. And then, to connect with the story I mentioned, that is one of the signs of the canonical Gospels. Always connecting with the previous story. The story of Jesus doesn't appear out of nowhere. That's one of our limitations or weaknesses when we preach the Gospel, as if suddenly that's where it begins with Jesus. Mm. It begins with the story of God's redemption that began in Genesis 12, when God's creation, good creation, humankind goes their own way, messes up things, violence, degradation goes on, and finally they reach Babylon. And then God calls from Babylon, Abraham, to bring about a people who will bring redemption for the world. So Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, they go into Egypt. God brings through Moses a people waiting for Israel to be the light to the nations. That was the purpose of God. But then this son of David, this son of Abraham has now come. He is the Messiah. Mm-hmm. So the connection of the story we find here in Matthew chapter 1. And one of the things about Matthew is, as I mentioned, he likes to connect the story with the Old Testament passages. Many places he may say, this was to fulfill what happened in, let's say, in the birth of Jesus, chapter 2, Micah is quoted that he will be born in Bethlehem. But more often in Matthew and in other Gospels and even in the other writings of the New Testament, there are so many allusions to Scripture. And anyone who notes Scripture, when I'm using Scripture now here as the Old Testament, what we call Old Testament, when you think of that, they will realize that here is Scripture coming out without saying it is quoted or cited. Mm-hmm. Now, for that, you need to know Scripture. One of the best places to think of that is something in our time. 1963, the famous message of Martin Luther King Jr. I have a dream. One of my favorite things to listen to. Now, but if you listen to that carefully, you realize, by the way, Martin Luther King Jr. was a Baptist pastor. So where do you expect his language to come from, his ideas to come from? Obviously, from Scripture. So when he says something like, I have been on the mountaintop. Now, somebody who does not know Scripture doesn't realize that he's speaking of when Moses was there on the mountaintop. He saw the people. In fact, Martin Luther King, MLK, says that, I may not be there in the promised land. And sure enough, he was shot and killed soon after. So there are a lot of resonances in that speech. He will say, every valley shall be lifted up and all the mountains and hills shall be brought low. This very, very bringing down injustice, you know, this kind of language that he uses without saying he's quoting Scripture. Now, for that is why when we read the Gospels, we should be on the lookout and be thinking, how does this connect with the Scripture in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures? So that is another beautiful thing about Matthew. The next thing to remember is Matthew has, like every other gospel writer, arranged the gospel in a certain way. Okay? This is his arrangement. He has received the material and the writer has put it together. There is a special connection to Matthew, I believe, is there behind this, whoever the author is, writing in Greek here. And he has decided to put it as in a certain way. And he puts it into five big teaching blocks. So these are like the pillars of the teachings of Jesus. Let me just show us how we can look at that. Chapter 5. 5, 6, 7 is considered the first block of teaching, right? And very often called the Sermon on the Mount. But when you read this carefully, you will realize, by the way, it cannot be one sermon. He's brought in a lot of material from different places and puts it together. And very interesting, at the end of every block of teaching, he will give you a clue. There is a formulaic ending. For example, here 5:2 says, and he began to teach them. And then you have this whole, blocks of teaching going on and on and on till the end of chapter 7. And when you come to 7:28, it says, when Jesus had finished saying these things, you saw that. So in other words, that is the end. He has shown you that's the end. He has another block of teaching coming in chapter 10. Chapter 10, he will say, verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. And the end of that is visible only in our chapter division 11:1, where it says, after Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples. Just to remind our listeners that these chapter divisions came much later, in the 13th century, 1200s. So that's the ending of this block of teaching. The third block of teaching is in chapter 13. That's all the parables of Jesus. Verse 3 will say, 13:3, then he told them many things in parables. And what Matthew does is, he puts them all together in another block of teaching. And at the end of that, look at verse 53. When Jesus had finished these parables. You see that? So he makes a clear point here, that's the end of those parables. Then he has another block, the fourth block in chapter 18. And when he finishes that block again, you will find the formulaic ending, but this time it's in 19:1, when Jesus had finished saying these things. So that's another block is over. And finally, the last block begins in chapter 23. Then Jesus said this to the crowds and to his disciples. These are all collections of the sayings of Jesus by Matthew. And when does it end? It comes, please turn in your Bibles to 26 verse 1. So 23, 24, 25 is the last block. When Jesus had finished saying all these things. Now, that is so beautiful. Matthew puts it all together in these five blocks. And that is one of his important emphases in this book. Jesus is the new Moses, the one greater than Moses. See, so at the end, for example, when we come to the end of the book, Jesus is on a mountaintop. And there he tells, see, look at chapter 28, verse 16, when the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain. See the imagery of Moses on the mountain giving the law. And now he says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Somebody asks, what should I teach my people? I tell them, well, Matthew has put it in blocks for you if you want to teach the teachings of Jesus. So the focus on teaching, that pastoral care that you find Matthew is interested in. So Matthew has a focus on teaching. Jesus is the son of David. He's a son of Abraham. But he's also God with us. That is also one thing we read in the birth story of Jesus. Remember the birth story, God with us. So Matthew has a very special... I must mention this. We mentioned that the core message of Jesus, the good news is the kingdom of God. But Matthew prefers to use the word kingdom of heaven. I think it's because of his context, because of his way, just like in our Indian culture, not all wives call their husband by name. They have a respectful way in a certain cultures, we may call them, different way. So in the same way, Matthew generally prefers to use the word kingdom of heaven as a circumlocution for God, instead of saying kingdom of God. That doesn't mean kingdom of heaven is going away to some place called heaven. No. The kingdom of God has come, and our hope is that it will come in its fullness where? On earth. That's why Jesus told his disciples, pray, let thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So ultimately, that's our goal. We'll talk about the goal later. So Jesus is shown as the one who's a new Moses. That's why in Matthew 11, Jesus will say, come, learn of me. I will teach you. Take my yoke upon you. You don't have to bear the burdens of other yokes. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. Learn of me. I am meek and humble. So Jesus is the new Moses we have to learn from. And so Matthew has his own style of teaching things, his own way. Let me just show you one interesting thing. May interest some people. In the genealogy, there are three parts of the genealogy. From Abraham to David. Then David to exile. Then exile to Jesus. Approximately 14. I mean, though if you read carefully, it may not be 14. But verse 17 will say, thus there were 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 from David to exile, and 14 from exile to Messiah. And any clever, keen reader will ask the question, really? Are there 14? And if you look carefully, one example of that, in 1:8, the third part says, Jehoram was the father of Uzziah. But if you read, there are at least two places in the Old Testament you can check this out from, Kings and Chronicles. And you find there were three other kings between them. So, 14 generations is not 14 generations then. Oh, so the Bible has some mistakes? No. We need to understand that language in Scripture, the writers, just like we when we speak, we mean what we mean. We don't always mean what we say. So when Matthew's arranging this, he arranges it in 14. And one of the most best ways I have found to understand this 14 then is, remember what is the first word of this gospel? Genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, son of David. And David is 14. Now you may ask, how is that, Pastor? Well, you know, the Jewish people love to play around with letters. So when they look at the letters of the Hebrew alphabet, they give numbers to that. By the way, that's the only way to understand 666 later on coming in. It is not about computers and anything else. It is a number for, well, you can listen to my other things. It's Caesar, right? So here, when you write David, let's think of it in English, D-V-D. But in the Hebrew, it is Daleth is the fourth letter, Vav is the sixth letter, and again another Daleth 4. So 4 plus 6 plus 4 14. Is 14. So what Matthew has done is, he doesn't care whether it's 14 or 16 or 18 generations between here, but he arranges it in a Davidic form. In a Davidic form. And that is the way this, each of these gospels are literary masterpieces. And that's why I get fascinated and I get excited about this. I wish I had even more time to sit and become, you know, more specialized in each of these gospels. So Matthew's gospel is beautiful. It's different from the other gospels.